The Bible said, no man that warreth as a minister of righteousness will entangle himself in the affairs of this life. So it is not my position to get out and entangle myself in the affairs of this life. My position is not that they shouldn't be dealt with, and not that if you have a conviction about something, but you first got to understand what is right. And you can only teach somebody what is right when you are walking right yourself. I have to come and I have to bring people to Christ, because there's one thing in the scripture that will show us that how that we will know how to treat each other. Jesus said it like this: love one another as I've loved you. He also said, as you would that men do to you, do the same to them. How you lack to be treated, treat others. It did not say treat others the way they treat you. He did not say the way somebody do you, you get it back to them somehow. In fact of the matter, he said, you be not overcome of evil with evil, but you overcome evil with good. God has showed us how things, and it's our faith in God, and your faith in God, that's going to get you through trying times like this. When they came to get Jesus, pick him up for nothing wrong he had done, all planning on killing him, Peter reached and grabbed his sword, and he cut off one of the men's ear that came to get Jesus, soldier's ear. Now, let's bear in mind, Peter was not surgically dashing at an ear. That's what the end results was. The ear was taken off. But Peter was cutting at a neck and a head. And that man started coming and ducking, and he just got an ear. You would have thought Peter would have gotten commended by Jesus, but instead Jesus rebuked him, told him, put your sword up. That's why you call him Lord, is when you're facing trying times. Can you stand away from the norm? Can you take up to do what's right, even when it seemed to be favorable towards you? Jesus said he took the servant's ear and picked it up, took the soldier's ear and put it back on the man's ear, and surgically, without any stitches, attached the ear back to the cut ear. Hallelujah. All things was made by him, brother, since you think that's impossible. And then he turned to Peter. He said, put your sword up in your shield. He said, for all they that take the sword will perish by the sword. And he reiterated to Peter who was with him. He said, do you not know that at this present hour I can pray to my Father, and he have more than 12 legions of angels here? You think you need to defend me? My Father already know everything I'm going through. And you think you need to take up violence in your hand? But no, that's not your position. The Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. We cannot get off course. We got to stay on course whatever we may encounter. Fact of the matter, we're going to take this Bible this morning, and I'm going to give you some understandings of things that's supposed to be occurring in the Christian's church. But it's not, because people don't understand this Bible. They're all talking about a time, 1,000 years of peace on the earth. Now, they're talking about 1,000 years of peace. Well, what's going to happen to all these people on earth here now? If that's going to be 1,000 years of peace, what's going to happen to them? They're all getting saved? No. There are 1,000 years of peace, and we have already entered into Don't back up on me now. What has happened here is that we have not understood the scriptures. When it says the wolf and the lion shall lie down together. When it speaks about how the lion shall eat straw like an oxen. In order for a lion to eat straw, eat the same food that an oxen eat, his nature has got to be changed. He said, the bear and the kid shall lie down together. Well, people have taken this, and they just imagine all of these animals out there getting along together. But have you stopped to understand? God has already got animals in order, and they haven't changed their nature. The ones of us that are acting like bears and lions and serpents, it's people that he's talking about. And I'll show you. He's talking about nationalities. He's talking about people of other race, bitter rivalries, vendetta, been going for years, getting together in his holy mountain. Now let's go, we're going to start here at Isaiah 1. We're going to go through some scriptures here this morning. And I don't want you to close me out because I know you've been hearing, I know what you've been hearing. Christ's going to come and reign, and he's going to reign for 1,000 years of peace, and then everybody's going to go up to Jerusalem. No, you're looking at this thing carnal. This reign ought to be occurring now in the Christian church. And I'll show you. This is how it's supposed to happen. The prophet Isaiah prophesied in 11. And thou shalt come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, and the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, and the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And this is what he's going to do. And it shall make him a quick understanding in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge after the sight of the eye. He will not look at people in their flesh, in their nationality, in their color, in their stature in the world, ethnicity, or their financial conditions, and judge them. Neither will he reprove after the hearing of the ear. But in righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins, and faithfulness the girdle of his reign. His reign going to be in righteousness. His reign was not going to be as he set up a White House or Congress and Senate, but his reign was going to be, he's a king of righteousness. He's reigning in righteousness even now in the lives of those that have made him their Lord. He's reigning in their lives. And then he goes on down, said, the wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the kid, and the calf and the young lion and the fatlings together. Man, can you imagine a young lion and a calf? And a little child shall lead them, and the cow and the bear shall feed. Their young ones shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the oxen. And the sucking child shall play on the hole of apes. This is poison snakes. And the weaned child shall put his hands up on the cockatrice den. I mean, that's supposed to be some kind of animal that existed one time in prehistoric time. It had a resemblance of a chicken, but was poisonous as a snake, even as in his tail he could hit you. Just his tail touching you would destroy you. But he said this here, some would say that its existence is not now, and they cannot find it. But since the Bible said it was so, I got to believe it. They shall not hurt nor destroy. Where? In my holy mountain. They're not going to hurt nor destroy, not everywhere you go, in the clubs and in the street, but in my holy place where they're gathered. Because the Bible said in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountain. God's house is established in the top of the mountain according to Isaiah 2. You need to read that and go read it when you get a chance. I'm not going to it. And he said it shall be exalted above the hills. That's what it says in Isaiah 2. And he said all ethnics shall flow unto it. Let me go over it for some of you that still don't believe me. Let's go over here to Isaiah 2, because I see you frowning up. I know you've been talking about it's going to be peace on the earth. The Bible tells me evil men and seducers going to wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. You know, it's amazing how we can believe a doctrine and there's nobody Bible scripture that says there will be peace on the earth for 1,000 years. There's no scripture said that. But they take how the Satan was bound up for 1,000 years and they jump up and attach these two scriptures together and say that's going to be 1,000 years of peace. No scripture written. Now, I realize this. As men teach things in their congregation and organized religion teach, eventually it shows up in a new Bible, those same teachings. Whatever religion teaches, and as they come together and teach, it starts to show up in a new Bible, even in their commentaries and sometimes even in their writing. But you cannot rely upon these modern day Bibles to get the truth. First of all, you have got to serve God or be in a ministry where that ministry is following God to teach you and understand the truth. Now, we're going to see here where he says in Isaiah 2, the word of the Lord, the word of Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. It shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountain. Now that's God said this peace that was not going to destroy in his holy mountain. Let's keep it in that context. It will be no destructiveness among God's people. And it shall be exalted above the hill in all nations. That means it will be open to all nations and all nationalities upon the earth. You will find this new movement that came through Jesus Christ will draw all men to him. And he said, all nations shall flow unto it. And many people shall go and say, come ye, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord's house, the God of Jacob. And he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his path. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Hallelujah. And listen what he goes to say what's going to happen. And he shall judge among the nations. The nations will still be existing, but they will come together. Black, white, Hispanics, Asians, Caucasians. And he shall judge among the nations, and he shall rebuke many people. Why is he going to have to rebuke many people? Because people have these stereotypes of all nationalities have them, and that I've witnessed when it comes down to nationality. Except you are of this crisis, and you are filled with his spirit. He shall judge among the nations, and he shall rebuke many people. He ain't going to rebuke all. He's going to rebuke some that still yet want to fight in war. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares. Now, when you beat a sword that you have to protect you from the enemy, you turn around and take it and use it to plow your ground with. You don't even want it sharp no more. You must not be expecting a fight, because the sword was a weapon of fight, a war. Just like today, we'll use a pistol. People use a pistol. Or a knife. Jesus is talking about in his holy mountain, you will not find strife and contention. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. A pruning hook is what you clean out the garden with. Their swords and their spears that they dagged at one another threw to hit a man way off with it. They will no longer use it. They're going to use it to prune stuff out of the garden because they're going to recognize a place would be established in the earth. And it's a spiritual realm. It's not a particular location over here, over there. When the disciples asked Jesus when the kingdom of God would come, he said, the kingdom of God come not with observation. He said, you have said neither here or there. The kingdom of God don't go, don't look over here, over there. He said, behold, the kingdom of God is within you. Now, when he tells us God's kingdom is in us, a kingdom is where a king rules. I'm trying to tell you how God is establishing these last days. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world, is what he rebuked Peter for wanting to fight with his sword. He said, if my kingdom was of this world, then my servants would fight. He said, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's righteousness, it's peace, and it's joy in the Holy Ghost. That's why he told us to seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Because God's kingdom is where he's in authority. The beginning Christian, his first prayer to God should be, thy kingdom come in earth as it is in heaven. God is not going to set up a kingdom in Washington, D.C. His kingdom will come in earth. What kind of earth? In this earthly tabernacle. God is not reigning in the courthouse. They make laws in the Senate, in the Congress, according to their own desire. But where God is ruling and reigning is in a people that renders their life to him and to submit to his word. Then he has control and he's ruling over their lives today. You're waiting for a time for it to come. People was, they were asking him when the kingdom would come. He said, the kingdom is already it's in you. Because it's peace, it's joy. It's righteousness in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom will never of God will never be classified in this earth realm as a location, particular, unless in that location there are people that are sold out and devoted to God. So he goes on to say, Verse 4 again, and he shall judge among the nations, and he shall rebuke many people, and they shall break their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. Now, people are looking for such a time to come in these last days. But what have they failed to realize? The Bible said before the coming of the Lord will come, it said the world will become more wicked, become more like Sodom and Gomorrah. Time will come, whoever kill you will think he's doing God a service. People are going slaughtering innocent people, and they're calling it jihad or whatever kind of war they got. That is wrong. People are not our enemy. We are not wrestling against people. The Bible said, let me show you what it says. Let's go here to the book of Ephesians. Book of Ephesians chapter 6, if you would. Let's read verse 10 so you may really get clear what Jesus is trying to tell us. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. Every nation wants a strong army. Presidents have won presidency because they say, I'm going to build a stealth bomber. I'm going to build more stealth planes, more nuclear weapons, more machine guns, more ships. Here's Paul telling you about this kingdom. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Said nothing about the power of a horse, power of a bullet, power of a gun, and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God. Now, he's telling us to, man, get dressed up, ready for warfare. All of us should be ready to fight. All of us ought to be ready to fight. But what are we fighting for? Are we fighting for our earthly cause? Are we fighting for a spiritual cause that will really govern the earth in the right realm? It will bring the earth back to what God intended for it to be. He said, for we wrestle, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now he's telling us that we ought to stand against the Satan's wiles. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. Our warfare is not against flesh and blood. Have you ever thought somebody with the flesh and the blood was your enemy? Change it today. Change it today. I don't care what they done to you. I don't care how you felt about what. Change. Your warfare is not against flesh and blood. Somebody may have looked a certain way that did something to you. Somebody may have looked in the way that you've seen or similarities that hurt you, hurt your mom, hurt your daddy. You have got to let God's spirit in what he teaches us be how we live our lives. It says we are not wrestling against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world. There are people that are ruling and those that are in authority, radio hosts, people that's in the Senate, we're wrestling against principalities and powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. In the new modern Bibles, they've taken that spiritual wickedness in high places out of there, and they've put in there, we are wrestling against spiritual wickedness in the heavenly places. See, these new modern Bibles just change all kind of words to give you something you think it's the same. It is not. It just told you we are wrestling against rulers of darkness of this world. This world. In the world we're looking at, rulers of darkness. He told you we are wrestling against principalities. Principalities are territorial rulers. I'm going to tell you some principalities. Your Congress is a principality. Your Senate is a principality. Your mayors and your judges are principalities. They're rulers. They set the rules. They turn around and say it's all right for same-sex to marry, and if you say something about them, they'll put you in jail. They'll turn around and tell you don't whip your boy. If you whip your boy and he's 13 years old, he get a little strap on him. They'll put you in jail. You lose. You can't take care of the child or nothing because you put a little mark on him. They'll tell you abuse that child. That child go out in the streets and break a law. They shoot him down in the street and justify the people that kill him. Same little boy that the parent couldn't whoop. Isn't there something wrong? And I'm not against. I'm wanting you to know it's the rulers of darkness that have entered in and changed everything that God has put in order that's got us in the mess we're in. My children said they're going to, I know, that's why I was saying, some of you, you know, I said to some of the young people that I wouldn't marry somebody young, and it wasn't because I have any indictment against somebody young. I just figured, I'd have to raise children, and I'd take strap out on little Johnny. Because I'm from the old school. Like I went to school and whipped my child right in school. Put a strap on him right there. I've done that. See, and what they've been done to your bishop, I be trying to straighten up this little bad boy you've been having for 5 years, and he want to go in there and throw those temper tantrums and throw up stuff on the wall. I been in there and got some on him. And then they wind up putting me in prison. Me sitting there for 20 years. I believe he that spareth his rod hateth his child. This is my Bible. God made this and put this in this word. And he gave illustrations. Solomon wrote about whipping your child more than anybody. You read the book of Proverbs. Solomon experienced it firsthand. And okay, y'all don't understand whip. Spanking. Black folks have said whip. Whites have said spanking, but we're talking about the same thing. Because some people, when you say whip your child, they think you got a big old whip out there popping them. Pow! Because in truth, in time of old, people did really take whippings or chastisement with the actual whip. So really, there are some people think whipping is violent behavior. But I chasten every one of my children. I didn't have to go and get them out of prison, go visit them in prison. But my sons and my daughters didn't have babies out of wedlock. Got 9 of them. Graduated them from college, all of them. Because I followed this Bible teachings. When I came up in school, the teacher could whip you. The coach had a paddle in the gym. Some of y'all remember the paddle. That paddle is what you needed. But we have these politicians that know nothing about God, don't believe in the Bible, and everything that the Bible said, they want to go contrary to it. Now, don't get mad with me. I'm just trying to tell you what has caused the decline in our society.